worship and praise and never find your way home. If your home is anywhere than heaven, get lost in worship and praise. Let glory fill your soul. Come worship the Lord. We worship you. We worship you. Hallelujah. They took the sacrifice and they bound the sacrifice where the hands were tied and the feet were tied, but this time bound differently and laid upon the wood. The hands and the feet were bound to a cross. So that the sacrifice might be made ready. Father called you and I to come live in this wonderful offering. Come partake of this altar. Hallelujah. That God the Father himself built. He told Abraham, he said, go and build me an altar in a place that I'll show you. So Abraham left that day just under divine direction. He didn't really know where he was going. God didn't tell him where he was going. There's no indication at all that he knew where he was headed out to. It was about a 3 days journey. About a 3 days journey. But the day that God told him, Isaac was already dead. One day there's going to be some people of God that are going to rise up with a special anointing from heaven. Listen to me. Listen very carefully. God gave Bazael the ability to look into heaven and see what went on in heaven, and there was no possibility of relating to it from anything that he experienced or saw in the earth. So Father gave to Bazael a special ability and a special anointing of wisdom to be able to see into heaven so he could create all the things that belong to the tabernacle and all the vessels and all the things that belong to the realms of God, that we may begin to see a bit of heaven. You know, that same spirit of wisdom, that knowledge of the Lord was upon Joshua, because Moses laid his hands upon Joshua and he received a spirit of wisdom. With that spirit of wisdom, he had spirit knowledge that he could command the moon and the sun to stand still and not move, and it had to obey him. Well, God's going to give some people some spirit knowledge to be able to begin to show these things in a realm that we have never, the church has remained powerless to go into the realms of the most effective media that exist on the planet. Yeah, I tried last night to watch another Christian production called The Bible. And not only did I notice that once again there must be some kind of virtue in their mind to say it differently from the Bible. It would be so simple for them to just keep with the script of the word, but yet they got to depart from it. And then there's no glory. There's no talent. And it just provokes me. I want to get a hammer and beat the thing. You know what I'm saying? No, there's a zeal on the inside of me that consumes my life. And I want some other people to become infected by it. Hallelujah. I want some other people start giving their life for something instead of sitting around waiting for another day. I said, my goodness, I'm getting ready to be 57. I haven't done anything. She said, don't say that. You're going to make everybody feel bad. Well, the reality of it is, I mean, look at the mountain. It's in the way. But look at the mountain of inheritance. The church could have stepped in. The church could have stepped in. Everybody sits around and they complain and they got all these ideas about how it all works. But let me tell you reality, okay? Let's just look at what happened. Let's just look at what took place in 1914 and 1916 when the church had the opportunity to step in and advance these things that ultimately came the ability to reach the entire world. No, a couple of brothers, Jewish brothers, stepped in and did it. Who came to be called the Warner Brothers, but that wasn't their name. It was a very difficult name to pronounce. Jewish name. Huh? When Grandpa Myers, think about this. When Grandpa Mayer, forgive me, when my family's Myers. When Grandpa Mayer was locked into the street at night, his family was locked in, and all Jews were locked in Frankfurt, Prussia. The most persecuted people were not allowed to have any possessions. All their possessions could be confiscated at any time without any notice. They had no rights. Grandpa Mayer said, I'm going to take over the financial system of the world. No, this is what he did. He said, I'm going to take over the financial system of the world. Here's his process of thinking. We are God's people. We are being persecuted. And I'm going to stand up in the promises, and I'm going to possess for my people the wealth of the world. Within one generation, in two generations, he owned all the banking systems. They're called the Shield of the Red Banner, or Rothschilds. And everybody's got all their ideas. No, Grandpa Mayer said, I'm done. I'm taking over. The church sits around going, and with all these excuses, with all these things going down, we don't realize our authority. We've lived on a different kind of ground. We've had a different kind of footing. Father wants to bless us with the riches of the ages, but he's called us to the fear of the Lord that no one really wants to understand and walk in it, because there's great wealth there. There's great riches there. There's great honor there. In fact, Proverbs said, chapter 14, what is it? I believe it's Proverbs 14, like 25 or 26, says, the fear of the Lord is a fountain, and by it we escape all the snares of death. It's riches, it's honor, huh? It's wisdom, it's knowledge, it's understanding. When you read, like, for example, in Proverbs chapter 2, verse 5, and they're describing finding the fear of the Lord and the knowledge of the holy, you know, it's all about going after the things that God's word describes to us that belongs to spirit knowledge. It belongs to a different way of thinking. God's not asking us to go after wisdom and knowledge and understanding that belongs to the world. He's asking us to go after wisdom and knowledge and understanding that belongs to the realms of heaven, which we get insight to and we get authority and power to participate with, because we take heed unto the word of God, because we lay hold on it and we don't bend or bow to nothing. It's God's word and that's it. We're not going to compromise or say anything that in any way is going to depart from what he described, both for spiritual needs, our spiritual state, our spiritual life, our physical needs, our physical state, our physical life. And I pray today that you guys would be just consumed with a hunger and a desire to lay hold on the things that it takes to go and preach the gospel. And you know, I don't know what I'm going to preach it until somebody gets it. For right now, the Lord says I've got to go to Kashmir. I'm going to go to Kashmir, and you know, we're going to go lay down our life there and see what all Father will do. But I pray that some of you begin to say, wait a minute, you know what? I can become more influential. I can go around and start prophesying. I can go around and start bragging on the Lord. I can go around and talk to people about the need to quit taking $40, $50 million and building a sham program like they did in the Bible series of God's money to go and preach the word wrong and to show it wrong. So aggravating. I pray that you become such a worshiper. You'll be so caught up. Jesus poured out his blood at Calvary's cross so you could live his life. You know, the Lord spoke to me about 6 months ago, and you know, I've just been waiting on the Lord about what he wanted me to do in America besides just what Father's had us do here in the local area in San Diego County, Southern California. Because the Lord's had us busy. We've had our ups and downs. We've had, you know, great things happen. We've had things that looked like that it was going to explode to heaven, you know, and that the whole nation was going to be saved. And then, you know, it calmed down again. And, you know, we had 1 year, we had 50,000 people go through the ministry in 1 year. And after the dust settles, there's like about 50 people. It's okay. I'm just doing what God told me to do. I'm not counting heads. That's, you know what I'm saying? There's something far bigger than the numbers of people that are influenced. Huh? That stay. There's a lot of people influenced, but how many people are influenced to the point of staying? And so, you know, the Lord just sent us to different places in the nations of the earth. Thank you, Jesus. Is this thing off? So what's wrong? It does help to turn it on, doesn't it? Like, what's going on with the mic today? And you can be seated. And about 6 months ago, the Lord spoke to us and, you know, I told Anna, I said, the Lord's going to use us. We're going to start in a different way. Of course, the church and what we're doing here and the places that the Lord's put on our heart to plant churches, this is first most, that's second most, but we're also going to do the utmost. Okay. Yes. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And we really want to raise up more people. I praise God for the people that are left out of here that are all over, you know, and doing great things in God. I mean, I'm so blessed to see what's going on with Kelly Leger now. And I mean, he's just running wide open. So many doors have opened up for him. And I'm just so blessed to see the anointing, the flow that is in his life, both in the Word and in the Spirit. And there's so many people I could talk about that way that is left here. And I'm thankful for everything that God has done. You know, and I want the Lord to use you. I want you to learn how to flow in the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Not in a model that is set before you, but necessarily by men, not even by me, but that which God the Holy Ghost teaches. That really finds its whole expression in the unlimited authority that Jesus Christ described and displayed to us, and that he said is yours, anybody, anyone. Some people talk about, you know, just the apostolic commission. No, Jesus didn't give an apostle. John 14:12 is not an apostolic commission. It's for anyone.
Yes.
It's for anyone who believes. These works shall you do. Jesus gave us his life to go do it. Now listen to me. And so, you know, I believe that, once again, I want you to understand, I'm totally committed to seeing everybody that comes through here and comes through any place we can possibly touch, to see them so stirred by the passions of God that you get so hungry and get so thirsty that you can lay hold on this ministry that's been made available to you. But the Lord told us, he said, I want you to go and start. I'm going to send you. I'm going to open up doors. I'm going to send you. I want you to go tell people to receive the life of Jesus. I want you to go to the church and tell people to receive the life of Jesus. I mean, I've been in many places. I've watched it over and again. The Lord told me I was on my way to work. It's 1994. I was on my way to work. I was working for biomedical company, a startup company, ID Biomedical. And on my way to work, the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me, because see, God speaks to me out of the realms of the of prophecy that flows out of the innermost part of my being. I'm just walking around praising, worshiping the Lord. In that particular instance, I was sitting around in the car praising and worshiping the Lord. And out of my belly began to come this prophecy and this declaration. The Lord speaks to me right through my own mouth. You know that the Lord could do that? Does that shock you? He speaks to other people through your own mouth. Why wouldn't he speak to you through your own mouth? Hallelujah. Huh? I believe people need to know how to exhort themselves to start off with, then they can exhort somebody else. Amen. Hallelujah. They need to get a prophecy for themselves. I didn't need to run around and get a prophecy. I have the prophet living on the inside of me, the Holy Ghost. And so the Lord said to me, he said, because then in those days, I mean, really by and large, from 1980, well, you know, I did ministry in the Calvary Chapel back in the days when the Calvary Chapel was still earnest for the outpouring of the Holy Ghost. And then in 1982, I stopped doing ministry there and we just focused on ministry here. So from 1982, really, until 1994, it was just about, I was bivocational, I was running wide open with work every day and church every night. And Mom had a bunch of little kids, and a bunch of little kids came along. We didn't say, you know what? We got now Joshua, Daniel, and Elizabeth, three kids in diapers. We don't need to do church every night. No, it was just all the more radical in our spirits to do it. And that's just the way I live my life. That's the way we lived our life, you know. And a great life. Somebody said, oh, that just sounds hard. It was beautiful. Beautiful then, beautiful now. And praise the name of Jesus. Whew. It's great living for God. And, but you know, I have a different measure of living for God. Mine's not based upon things that are earthly and what you see earthly. Mine's based upon a heavenly realm, an interaction of with Him, hearing Him say, well done, a good and faithful servant.
You know, I can tell people, I can train people how to hear God say to them every day, well done, my good and faithful servant. Huh? So you don't have to wait till the last day. Huh? Would you like to be trained this morning?
Yes.
To hear every day, well done, my good and faithful servant. Just be in Jesus and hear what Father says to Jesus. It's pretty simple. Huh? It's just training you to live in Jesus, and you'll hear what Father says to Jesus about you every day. Praise God. Then 1994, I'm on my way to work, and the Lord said, I'm going to call you to meet everybody I've raised up in the earth, and you're going to travel with them. And I'm just going, wow, Father. You know, because almost every day I was prophesying, is anything too hard for me, says the Lord. And I'd say, no. Is anything too hard for me? I'd say, no. But, you know, during those days, I mean, what I did, my commute was like 45 minutes, 60 minutes. I was one of those guys who read going down the road. I memorized literally books of the Bible. Just gave myself to the Word. Just memorizing the Word. It's pretty easy to do it. Just imagine. 4 verses on the way to work. 4 verses on the way home. How many days? Huh? You give yourself to memorizing the Word of God 365 days a week. Huh? Times 4. Times 20. Get a lot of verses in there, right?
Yes.
You start going back over things. You know what I'm saying to you? Hallelujah. That's a hunger and it's a thirst. It's not a religious exercise. It's religion until you don't do it. But the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of the Son, will come on the side of you and make you so hungry for the Word you can't live without it. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Jesus showed us how to overthrow the greatest. Satan did it. Satan and hell did its worst and brought all of its power to bear. And Jesus showed us how to overcome all the forces of hell with Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3. Just Deuteronomy. Somebody said the Old Testament. It's old. It's passed away. Deuteronomy 8, 3 destroyed the powers of Satan in terms of the way he came at the man Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Man should not live by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. There it is. That's the chief theme of our life. But at any rate, you know, the Lord told us, hallelujah. Turn this up. Just leave the knob up and just kind of just back away. But at any rate, the Lord showed us. I appreciate trying desperately to get it right. It's tough. I get to work. I'm in an obscure lab that I helped put together that really nobody should have known about because it was like discovery research. It was not applied. It was discovery. Okay? You know, there's the remote little cubicles, you know, in town. And get to work and I get a phone call. Says somebody said, hey, there's someone on the phone for you. Someone like named Francis or something. So I said, hello. This person on the other side says, hey, Pastor Mark, this is Francis Hunter. Have you heard of us? We've heard of you. I'm like, how on earth? I'm thinking, how did she get my number? How did she get my telephone number? Charles and I want to come to your church tomorrow night. I said, well, come on. Then the next day, another thing happened. The next day. And before long, you know, I'm traveling with Carlos Anacondia and this one, this one, and that one, and the other, and the other one. And just looking at what's going on in South America, North America, up in the Northwest Territory, and the Lord just seeding us, you know, getting us ready for things.
Amen. Yes.
Just showing us the landscape of what's going on. Yes. Sometimes I'd watch people get touched by the real glory of heaven, and then they didn't do anything with it. We'd be in meetings, and there'd be 30 to 50,000 people in the meeting. I'd see almost the same crowd come up every night to receive salvation, kind of thing. Father, you got to do something here. I praise you for what you're doing, but you know, you got to do something here. You got to just, what does it take? What does it take, Father, for you to get men to cooperate with you? I want to cooperate with you. What does it take for you to get me to cooperate with you? Do it. Here am I. And then in 1995, the Lord had us to start. 1995, it was crazy. Let me tell you how it was, okay? We had this beautiful, you know, facility, three buildings, building A, building B, building C, just, you know, just everything you needed, okay? School, classrooms, huge sanctuary. One building was huge sanctuary. One building was classrooms. Another building was a huge fellowship hall. And they told us, well, they heard some bad things about us, that we were flowing in the Holy Ghost over there in their church building. Speaking in tongues and everything. And so that we had to go. That's an amazing thing. You know, I never cease to be amazed at people's logic. And so I went looking around. And everywhere I would look, I just like feel like nothing. I feel nothing, no direction, nothing. I'm going. So I told the church, it was Sunday, I said, guys, no, forgive me. It was Sunday, and then it was Wednesday night too, but Wednesday night was the big impact. Because I said to the church, I said, listen, so far as I know, we are going to cease to exist as a church. Because I have no direction for a building. We're being kicked out. As far as I know, at most, we would meet in a park somewhere that is yet undisclosed. It's wonderful to take your life and just lay it on the altar and be so happy about it all. Yeah. Because you're devoted to going in the direction that God teaches and leads you rather than the things you can come up with your creative mind. God gave me a creative mind. I can tell you, I can imagine, you know what I'm saying? I can create things in my mind, believe things in my mind. Huh? But the Lord taught me how to hear His voice. Sitting before His word, I can hear His voice. He taught me how to listen to His voice. Just like He taught Samuel. Hallelujah. You need to lay down your, you know, Eli laid down in his, he was fat and blind. So fat he couldn't move, and blind didn't help out either. Hophni and Phinehas laid down with the women and oppressed the people. But little Samuel laid down in the holy place and ministered into the lampstand, which represents the revelation of God, the Word of God. Hallelujah. And there he was taught to walk in the Word of God and hear the voice of the Lord, insomuch that God did not allow one of his words to fall to the ground. Whatever Samuel said came to pass. Hallelujah. That's if God's done that for one person, he's done it for anybody who wants to step in. And by the way, Samuel was not baptized in the Holy Ghost. He had a measure of the Spirit. When I look at these men in the Word, in the Bible, and one of the things that they do, you stay in the Word of God, you should stay in the Bible. Reading the Bible, it'll ruin you. It'll ruin you of false expectations and make-believe. And you look at what all these great men of God did and who they were without the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Then look at the model of the baptism of the Holy Ghost, Christ Jesus and the Apostle Paul. And you go, Lord, I want to step into this. And Father's going to reward hunger and thirsting. You know, Moses knew as a little child that he was destined to greatness. So did his parents. He understood how that God would deliver Israel by his hand at an early age. Listen to Stephen's testimony in Acts chapter 7. Huh? But he wasn't 80. He had to wait till he was about 80 before he was prepared to step into it. By then, most people don't give up. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
You just walk in faithfulness and obedience to God. I'm telling you, people, Father has great things going to do with your life. In one day, He could take and use your life in such a way that if you would have lived 10,000 years, you couldn't have accomplished that much. One day, just one day. One day in God's presence, and you passionately pursuing, knowing, one day being used by Him in a way to where that is unimaginable. But then what happened is the next day the Lord directed me, said, this is what I'm going to give you. See, the Lord waits to see if we're going to go ahead and make our decision on our own or whether we're going to listen to Him. So I laid it on the altar. The Lord took me and showed me this huge property. Bill Clinton had shut down the Naval Training Center. He just to come into office. Something like that. So I recollect. And basically, we took over the galley where they had fed the Navy since World War II and before. Everybody went in there and cleaned the thing out. It could seat 2,000 to 3,000 people. And we just started inviting everybody who I had already met over those few years, 2 years between. And that's what the children were raised in. Had a woman come the other day. Said, last time I was here with you guys, I remember your children were real little and you guys were over there on the Naval Training Center. Yeah, we were. They were. And Joshua and Daniel had the authority of taking care of all the traffic. And he was constantly, just one thing after another, great things. Had over 160 pastors from the region meeting together. And it was all Holy Ghost people. Because I'd stand up and say, listen, if you're not hungry for God, if you don't believe signs, wonders, and miracles, if you're not passionate about God coming with the glory of heaven, like on the day of Pentecost, you don't even want to come with us. And out of that, and just being very clear, no ecumenical, nothing. Just here it is. I'm going to open up the Bible and read to you what we're going after. It was over 160 pastors. It's all documented on www.revivesandiego.com. It's just documented. That thing is just there as a testimony. The Lord for 5 years. It's 5 years. Right at 5 years. It ended with having Carlos Anacondi out in our big athletic field, you know. And there must have been, I don't know. We had a lot of people out there. And it was about a different crowd every night. At least 50% different every night. You listening? You know what I'm saying? About 50% different every night. Probably on average about 4,000 to 5,000 people were that many chairs out there. Ten nights. How many of you here remember that? We were busy. We were working real hard. And then after that, the Lord started sending me to nations, and Tim Hall invited me to come do a crusade with him in Papua New Guinea. And so I just thought I was just going to go just hang out and help out. Then on the biggest night, there was tens of thousands of people there. They said there was 50 to 60,000 people there. Friday night was the biggest night. Tim, I get up that morning, Tim says, you're preaching tonight. I'm like, what? I mean, this is a big night. You should preach. And you're doing it. And so after that, then the Lord just started doing one thing after another. And the just vision just kept enlarging. Things kept enlarging in our spirit. And it'd be too much to begin to talk about all the details of it right now, of all the stuff that happened from all the various different nations that the Lord sent us to the Mission Training Center and other things that God did. But then, you know, 6 months ago, and I like a lot of times when I'm talking about what God did in the past, but when I'm getting ready to talk about what God's doing now, I like to talk about what God did in the past. I just encourage myself in the Lord, because I kind of find myself right now is similarly talking to you out of the same kind of realm when, and in 2008, we showed up to do the crusade that had never been done in the nation of Nepal, in their icon of Hinduism, the kingdom of Hinduism, capital Hinduism, and the icon of Hinduism, into the national stadium. And the guy who was the first missionary to Nepal came to Nepal in 1952, an old man. He was the guy who was head over the organization and organizing it. And I got there, and the head over the organizing it said, you know, I'm not going to be a part of this because I just believe it's going to be, it's just not going to work out, you know. The stadium is huge. It holds 40,000 people, and it would be amazing if there was even 5,000 people in it, and I just can't be a part of it. And the Maoists told us they were going to kill us. And so then basically, so we already knew what the Maoist threats were when we got there. But when we got there, I hear all of the stuff. And it's the day, you know, it's the day before the thing's going to go down. And I'm hearing all these threats and all these things where people are backing out, doing this thing and doing that thing. You know, so what I did? I just sat down and I talked about all the miracles. I talked about how that it was impossible to get the national stadium. I talk about all the things. I talk about what God did there in 2006. I talked about what God did everywhere else over the past, since we've been going and doing things, you know, internationally. And then Ann and I come driving around the corner the next night. I mean, we're hearing all these stories, but we're just encouraging ourselves in the Lord. We guard our heart with all diligence. We encourage ourselves in the Lord. And the next day we came around the corner and we saw these buses, I mean, lined up as far as you could see. People were not only packed in these buses, they were hanging on the sides. They were up on the top. It was amazing. And they all had these big smiles on their faces. And they were all Hindus. Pretty crazy, eh?
Yes.
And the place is packed out. Now all the people who jump ship are back on ship. It was a phenomenon. They were mostly all Hindus. See, they were calculating how many Christians were going to make it. God went and got the Hindus. God brought the Hindus. Hallelujah. Kutaba ishe konamateya. I was going to have several different people. I invited T.L. Osborne to go because he had always prophesied one day the kingdom of Hinduism would have a massive evangelism crusade, and that one day had come. Wow. I had invited just everybody to come sit on the platform, and of course I would have honored them and let them minister, you know. Had Tim Hall coming. Tim Hall has already bought his ticket. He wakes up in the morning that he's supposed to go, and he's paralyzed. He's paralyzed for 2 days. Ask him. He couldn't move. He's paralyzed. He couldn't move. Somebody said, why? Because God wanted to do it through somebody who's nobody. He wanted to do it through someone who he'd get all the credit through. Amen. And this is nobody. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Potaranajaya. Havakona ishe. Porohonde. Father can do some great things with you without you having to advertise nothing about yourself. When we first went, in fact, went on the Paul, it was just a really cool thing to talk about. I love talking about it because when, you know, the Lord showed me that I was going, and then I called up a key person there and I just told him, hey, my name is Mark. I'm from San Diego. The Lord sent me to Nepal. He's like, why do you want to come here? I said, well, because the Lord sent me. What do you think is going to happen here? Well, if one soul gets saved, it would be a profound event, wouldn't it? Hey? And so, you know, it's just a real short conversation. It was early in the morning and I'm kind of like, you know, just talking like, you know, like this, not excited. Hey, yeah, my name's Mark, and got your telephone number from Bob. And I'm talking like that. There's no height, there's nothing, okay? I'm just doing it. Are you with me? Because God didn't need my advertisement. Jesus was always telling people, don't tell nobody. You know what I'm saying? It's like Father wants to be secretive about it, but you can't keep what God does a secret.
Yes.
And really why he's saying that is he's telling us we don't need to advertise. And just wait on him. Let him do it. He's big God. He can speak on his own behalf in a powerful and radical way. Whew. Hallelujah. The next morning, the guy calls me up and said, who are you? I said, I'm Mark from San Diego. The Lord gave him a dream. He's a dreamer. He's a great man of God. He's done great things in Asia. Sudeep Kadka will be with him at one of his churches in Norway. In April, on April the 14th and 15th. We loved them. Sudeep and Annalise gave their life, gave their life in the mission field. Amazing. Amazing what God's done through their life. And the Lord just spoke to him and said, this is who he is. And so they rolled out the red carpet from there. So we just, when all the things were coming out against us and the enemy was threatening, we just remind ourselves. Amen. We sit down and remind ourselves all that God did to get us here. And I just encourage you to do the same thing. And that's really tonight, or right now, that's what I'm doing right now. Because, you know, the Lord told me to go to the churches and tell them to receive the life of Christ, to receive the life of Jesus. Christ Jesus gave us his life so that we could live it. We're not living his life. By and large, we compromise right, center, and left. This is a glorious life. This is the life of the Spirit. This is a heavenly life. Hallelujah. This is a life that enjoys being around the Holy Ghost rather than around a bunch of demons.
Amen.
Hallelujah. This is a life of purity, that loves purity, that loves righteousness, that loves holiness, that loves cleanness, that loves purity of mind and actions and thought, that's grieved by sin and iniquity. God's a holy God. Heaven's a holy realm. I'm going to tell you, people say, well, I don't like to go to church. You won't like heaven. Somebody tell me, why do you go to church so much? Because it's so much like heaven to me. It's like heaven to me. It's like heaven to me. Because we're here this next week, so I'll do another School of Spirit on Friday night. I'm just going to talk to you on School of Spirit of what happens when you begin to just speak out the word. I don't care where you're at. You can be out in the woods by yourself, in your living room, in your bedroom. It doesn't matter. You just begin to speak out the word of God. You just begin to. Now, I know that a lot of people haven't spent enough time in the word to just speak out the word. Maybe you haven't memorized verses on a single subject or chapters of the Bible or books of the Bible. But you can start by just taking your word, the Bible, and just take an outline with a highlighter. Just go with a subject. Let's just say the subject is Holy Ghost. That's a great subject. Because you're not going to get anywhere till you start acknowledging God's here and start agreeing with Him. You ain't going to do nothing till you start acknowledging God's here and He's in charge and you're not.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And that He's no respecter of persons, neither is He a liar. He didn't create some, Jesus didn't die to create some religion for people to genuflex all over the place.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying to you here? But you just highlight the scripture, praise God, on Holy Ghost, and then just start walking around and just declaring the word of God. Hallelujah. Huh? Take the blood of Jesus and go in and take the blood of Jesus and that, that sacrifice that was made for us at Calvary. And just beginning, just declare these things out. Speak these things out. It won't be long. They'll just come right up out of your belly. You'll just walk around. You'll be able to just declare these things. And what will happen, and in this place of declaring His word, you begin to encounter a manifest presence of God's glory that goes beyond anything you've experienced. You will. You will. When you begin to speak His word to the place where you begin to agree with His word, oh, my. Whew. I'll tell you right now, it is exciting. Hallelujah. These things will change you. Oh, the power of that glorious declaration. So I'm not going to talk any more about it. I'm just going to let you know. It's just advertisement. I'm going to talk about that on School of the Spirit on Friday night. People, I am so earnest to see God's people begin to enjoy the heavenly life. And I'm telling you, if there's anything that you want to grab a hold of, it's and seize it with everything that is within you, is this wonderful flow from heaven that was provided for us in Christ Jesus. And He says and invites all of us to come dwell in it. He says, come dwell in me. I am the vine, you the branches, come dwell in me. You dwell in me, you're going to produce a fruit. What kind of fruit? You're going to produce a fruit that is an evidence of relationship with the Father on the level that whatever you ask Him, He'll do it. Now that's John 15. That's just John 15. That's just as context as you can get text. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. God.
We're getting ready to run to the churches of America.
Amen.
God's going to shake people.
Yes.
We are believing God, Father, because it's what Father is the word that the Lord put in our hearts. This is the word that the Lord told us to pray. This is the word He put in our mouth to speak unto Him. To cause men to so come under the grip of His Holy Ghost conviction and power that they shake like leaves on a tree in the midst of a windstorm. That's what the Lord put in their mouth. But you know, you're not going to have Holy Ghost conviction falling until you yourself begin to live in it. But and the place that's most difficult is where religion has seeded the hearts of men and have seared them, where they can go and sit down and look at pornography and then come and raise their hands towards God. Seared. Apostasy. And they believe they're Holy Ghost filled and on the way to heaven. Heaven's not made up of people like that. People just think, oh, well, you know, the Lord's merciful and good. He is merciful and good. He is. And so therefore, I'm okay, I'm gonna be all right. No, you're not. You're gonna be okay and all right doing that stuff. Because if God allows you into heaven, heaven become hell. As soon as God allows people that walk in sin and iniquity and do not want to change, God paid a high price for you and I to have His life before we had the death reign over our life. Death is an expression of demonic spirits, the power of darkness, the stronghold of Satan that caused men to go and run and hide, caused Adam and Hava or Eve to go and run and hide from God in shame and in fear, tried to make themselves clothes out of figs. Boy, they didn't know what fig leaves. They didn't know what they were doing. Think about that. You think about it. Who's going to become when they were really ignorant of, they just knew they were. This is what they got out of a promise from the devil. Huh? Nothing but separation from God. Dead. In the day that you eat, you shall die. You shall die. You shall surely die. Physically, they did not lay down and die. They died spiritually, cut off from God. Yet God in His love and mercy reached out to them and said, Adam, Adam, where are you at? We want to take that as a confirmation that they're all right. They're not all right. God made a blood sacrifice that day in declaration of a coming Redeemer and made for them coats of skin. Christ Jesus came, died at Calvary's cross, destroyed the power of darkness. He through death destroyed him that had the power of death, that is the devil, who through his death has brought life and immortality to light. And we want to continue on in all this mess. Give me a break. It's time to receive the life of Jesus. Fear of the Lord is very important to Father. It's part of the outpouring of the Holy Ghost. The Spirit of the Lord, Spirit of wisdom. You just take the Spirit of wisdom and look through the Bible and see what men of old did with the Spirit of wisdom, what great exploits they did through the Spirit of wisdom. But he said, the Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of wisdom, the Spirit of understanding. Look at what all these men did with the Spirit of understanding. The Spirit of the Spirit of might and the Spirit of counsel. And God's told us that we can be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of His might. What can stand against the strength of the Lord? What can stand against the power of His might? Nothing. That's every Greek word for power, all in one verse of Scripture in Ephesians 6:10, saying, I give you the summation of all power. I've given you by my divine power everything that pertains to life and godliness so that you can live in the glory and you can live in the virtue. And people want to compromise right, left, and center and say they got it going on and blame God for the lack of the evidence and the fruit and those things that would testify of that which the Word of God describes. Don't blame it on God. No. The blame is with us. Somebody's going to have to get passionate and start prophesying. Somebody's going to have to be willing to stand the test of time and adversity and not bend nor bow by all the persuasive argument of even good men. Huh? I really didn't need anybody to tell me where to walk with the Lord. He already told me long ago. He brought me to a place of the altar. He said, this is what I want you to be. My evidence and my proof is not some kind of idea created within the framework of my own mind and imagination, but is the very written Word of God. We dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly leaned on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock we stand, all on the ground the sinking sand. We can understand these things, these songs, these great songs that were born in the fires of revival and the holiness movement of the 1880, 1890, and 1900 brought some of the greatest fruit in the church in the modern age. The Moravians and their passionate pursuit of God, of a Holy Ghost move through prayer, resulted in George Whitefield, resulted in John Wesley, resulted really by virtue of that, resulted in the first Great Awakening that formed the United States of America. And its constitution was born in the fire. You can shake your head no, man, but this is the way it went down, buddy. Now come in this place and start shaking your head around, because it's defiance against God. We know our Bible, we know our history, we've given our life to it. And it's really a big part of what goes on in the framework of the church. It's a stubbornness, it's an arrogance, it's a defiance against God. There's principalities that right now rule in America. One of them is humanism. One of them is intellectualism. One of them is feminism. The list goes on, and it so infiltrates the church. But once again, as the Moravians prayed, I mean, they had a prayer meeting going on. Their prayer meeting went on for over 100 years. The wellsprings that came out of all of those things that happened then, the wellsprings that came out of the holiness revival that began in 1880, you know, songs like, "Take my will and make it thine, it shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is your throne. Take my heart, it is your own. It shall be your royal throne." It's a preacher's daughter. In this consecration, the consecration of the line. There's very few places with any consecration. There's very few places with anything even that looks like sanctification. To be set apart unto God's holiness. Jesus died to give us his life. He is the door for all those who want to escape sin and its wrath, because the wrath of God is still on sin as much as it ever was. The Word of God over and again declares in the New Testament God's wrath on sin. And the book of Revelation tells you and describes it in great detail about how Father's going to pour out his wrath on sin and iniquity. I don't care who says what. I know what God said. He's never changed. He's a holy God. He's a holy God, full of righteousness and purity, that even the prophet Isaiah, who stands in a place before the Lord, having been anointed of God to be able to declare God's word, yet encountering the wonderful holiness of God, says, "I'm undone." Job, even though God calls him upright and perfect, tamim, the Hebrew word for it is tamim, perfect and righteous and upright, yet when he begins to encounter Father on another level, in a way that he never had encountered it before, in Job chapter 40, said, "Once have I spoken, yea, twice, and puts my mouth, I'm putting my hand over my mouth, I'm speaking no more, I abhor myself. What I thought was beauty has now turned in, what I thought was comeliness has now turned into corruption." Huh. God is holy and pure and righteous and beautiful and everything that pertains to life, the majestic of his goodness and the majestic of his majesticness of his mercy. I mean, it's just undeniable. The Word of God describes it over and over again. Heaven has nothing but that which belongs to righteousness and holiness in it. Thus he gave us his life so that we could walk in the beauty and the splendor of his holiness. Thus he gave us the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of holiness. Hallelujah. His life, the same life he lived, the same life of heaven. Father's going after the tribulation, there's going to be 1,000 years of the reign of Christ where he's going to rule with a rod of iron. There won't be need for any kind of demolition team after the tribulation. By that time, there won't be a building standing on the earth. The mountains will be moved out of their place. The islands will be moved out of their place. Go read about it. Huh? In the first 3.5 years of the tribulation, approximately a little more than half of the population of humanity will have been taken out. Just think about it. That's not going to happen until there's no more harvest. Praise God. And we've got a window of time. It's going to get worse. Things are going to get worse. People are going to become more rebellious. They're going to become more defiant. The apostate church is going to rise to a greater state of defiance. That's what the Word of God describes to us. The glorious church is still going to be there. I wouldn't doubt that the glorious church ultimately becomes, the way it looks to me, to a persecuted state as it was in the first century. Think about it. Because we will be hated by all nations for his name's sake. He would say, the intolerable is not right for them to live. But we're going to run right now.
Amen.
We're going to run right now.
Yes.
Somebody says, "You're going to the Kashmir Valley." Why are you going to Kashmir Valley? Because there's 40 million Pashtuns that haven't heard the gospel. The Pashtuns are, they believe they're the descendants of Ephraim. They're radical fighters. That's why most of the Taliban is made up of Pashtuns. But they don't like me. They're going to love me. Because how beautiful are the feet of them. They're going to think, he's got beautiful feet. Hallelujah. We're going to run. We're going to run throughout the United States of America this year like never before. And it's just going to increase. I told Anna, I said, we're going to just try our best just to keep one week out of a month on the road. And major churches across the United States of America begin to open up to us. And now it's already gone into on some months already too. And we couldn't say no 2 weeks out of the month. But we're going to be here as much as we possibly can for Sundays. And there'll be some Sundays we can't be here on the Sunday morning, but we're going to be here on Sunday night. We're just going to, no matter how far away we are, except for when we're like in Kashmir. Senegal. You ever been to Senegal? You know where Senegal is though, right? You ever heard about Senegal? Because you guys are all the way, Kerala, all the way down to the south. It's all the way to the north, right? And then you got the mountain ridges of Pakistan and the mountain ridges of Afghanistan, China, and then Tajikistan. Those people never heard. There's 3 billion people that have never heard. 3 billion people never heard. I'm about to say, we're going to get you baptized in the Holy Ghost where you become fearless.
Yeah.
Fearless. It doesn't matter. We'll just send you wherever. I'm just convinced I can send Mike anywhere. I've already coined him for Kashmir Valley. No, read about Kashmir Valley. It ain't good for Christians. It is where the radical Orthodox Hindus meet the radical fundamentalist Muslims. They hate each other. Huh? Because the Muslims want to eat some beef, and the Hindus say you can't kill the beef. That's just one of the small problems. That's just one of them. You know, Muslims like one God, Hindus, 33 million. And it gets worse from there. Believe me. Those are just minor elements. But there's one person they hate more. They hate Christians, but they don't hate me. They hate religious Christians. They just haven't seen Holy Ghost filled Christians.
Right. Yeah.
They haven't seen people who concern for their need, who concern for their life, concern for their health and their well-being spiritually and physically, who walk into the house and lay hands on the sick baby. Whole nations turned to God through laying hands on a sick baby. It happened in Georgia, the nation Georgia, just above Armenia in the second century. A slave girl from Cappadocia was taken from Cappadocia to Georgia. And back in those days, they would take around a little baby if the baby got sick or a child got sick, and they would take them from house to house to see if anybody could recognize the disease. Maybe somebody had a cure. They get to the slave girl who's a Holy Ghost slave girl who doesn't have the rights over her own life. She can't go anywhere. She goes where she's told to go. Within the framework of an earthly existence. But that baby showed up at her doorstep. She said, yes, I have the cure.
Yeah.
She laid hands on the baby. In the name of Jesus Christ, the baby was completely cured. It didn't take long. Everybody knows about that in a small community. It didn't take long. The king of Georgia heard of what had happened. This is history, people. You can probably Google this. I don't recommend Googling for facts. I was watching that Christian movie last night and go, they Googled that information. Wikipedia, here you go. Okay, but no, Wikipedia is not even that bad. I'm not going to get on that subject anymore. I'm leaving that alone. I'm handing that over to the Lord. I want people to get stirred up. My God. But at any rate, King of Georgia heard about it. His wife, the Queen of Georgia, had a disease, bedridden disease for many years. They sent for the slave girl. The slave girl turns the whole nation to Jesus. The king, after the queen got healed, because the slave girl walked in, laid her hands on the queen just as she did the baby, prayed in the name of Jesus. The queen was instantly healed by the power of God. The king proclaimed Georgia a Christian nation, 2nd century AD. Amen. One slave girl. Ready to be used by God. Submitted to the Lord. Ha ha. Not willing to take any other stand. Not willing to be bummed out or overwhelmed by her circumstance. Whoo. There is no such thing as liberty outside the Holy Ghost. There's no such thing as freedom outside of this life in Christ Jesus.
Yes.
History proves it. There's only tyranny and dictatorships. When Mother Russia walked as the lighthouse of the kingdom of God, they were free. When they stopped, you know what happened. Before the gospel, they were a bunch of warlords fighting among themselves. Then the gospel, they were united under Gregory and others, right? Then all of a sudden, it got to the place where it was just nothing but religious and crazy religious stuff. By the 1900s, the Bolshevik Revolution. The UK, when the UK carried the torch of the gospel, and you had the UK on their face before God, crying out to God, where great revivals came from. That's George Whitefield. He was sitting on a bench at Oxford, in the common area, where all the students go to just kind of sit around in the park-like area of Oxford. And he had a revelation. He had a revelation. You know what his revelation was? His revelation was, you have to be born of the Spirit. It had been lost to the church. You must be born again. And so that's what would happen. He'd tell people about, you need to be born of the Holy Ghost. And when he was beginning to talk about being born of the Spirit, being born again, people begin to shake violently under the power of God. Just begin to talk about the Holy Ghost. Just in the new birth experience. Woo, man, I'm telling you right now. I am so excited about a holy people of God who are devoted to doing it all God's way, to give in their lives completely over to God, to be those under the power and reign of the Holy Ghost, under the sovereign rulership of Christ Jesus, the living Word, who's going to be teaching us the written Word, because the written Word is all about the living Word. He said, behold, I come in the volume of the book, is testifying of me, or it's written to me, from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21. Even though the New Testament had not been written at that point, it was already written, you with me, within the mind of God. Hallelujah. It's all about me, Jesus said. We're going to see these things because there's going to be a people of God. I've been saying the millennials are coming. I've been saying that there's a radical people who have no idea about the meaning and the value of the life. They're completely the wildest group of kids, or they're the most sold out group of kids. And I see the most sold out group of kids, and I know they're 24, and I should be saying adults. They could be as old as 24. But it's 18 to 30. 18 to 34.
18 to 34?
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
But don't worry, if you're not in that bracket, you're not going to get left out. I guarantee I'm 57 years old, I'm not going to get left out. And no way. No way. I was with the preacher one day, and this was like in the early 90s, and I said, I see a great move of God, of the Spirit coming. It's 1990. I said, he was in our living room. I said, I see a great moving of God coming in the United States of America. And I said, I'm going to be right at ground zero.
Amen.
And he looked at me, and he said, well, you can't say that. I said, well, why? And so he started giving me some of his theology. I said, well, scratch all that. Listen to me. I mean, right ground zero. Because then I gave him some of my relationship ideas. Hallelujah. Yeah. About how God do whatever you ask him to do. Woo! I was standing on a platform in 1997. There was more than 2,000 people in the building at the Abiding Place on the Naval Training Center. I think that night there was, goodness gracious, there were so many men of God in that place. And there had been so many men of God in that place, from Rodney Howard Brown to Randy Clark to you name them. I mean, just everybody. Wes Campbell, Carlos Anacondia. The names go on and on and on. It was just stacked up. And so I'm up there on the platform, and I saw him out there in the crowd. And I went, hey. And he's like, and then I went. And he knew exactly what I was talking about, even though it was 7 years later. Ground zero.
Hallelujah.
You determine. You just determine. I'm going to be in the move of God. Nobody's going to shut me out because God's already invited me in.
Amen.
And is there a price to pay? Yeah, there is.
Yes.
Abraham walked in faithfulness to the Lord in a radical way. God invited him into a glorious realm, but at great cost in certain respects, because now he's got to leave the place of his security. He's got to leave his homeland. He's got to leave everything that he's known, and he's got to go with God to a place that God's not going to tell him about. He's got to walk it out one step at a time. God's calling you to a place of glory. He tells you about the bigger vision. He gives you the 30,000-foot view, if you would. I'm going to make you great. I'm gonna use you to bless all the nations of the earth. And then he describes it to us in terms of the ministry of Jesus. You'll cast out devils, speak with new tongues. I mean, these works and greater works. I mean, oh, my life. You'll walk in and you'll know the love of Christ which passes knowledge and be filled with all the fullness of God. That's a whole lot of glory. I'm laying hold on these things. See, for me, this is the living word. It's reality. It's not, I could be in a prison somewhere in heaven. I could be down in a pit somewhere 5 stories down underground.
Yes.
Being taken out and beaten in the shins, hung up by my ankles and beaten in the shins, as some of my dear friends have on a daily basis, and still step into this realm. Because it's not limited to circumstance. It's about a communion of the heart with the Father, an invitation to come through Christ Jesus the Son and be filled by the Holy Ghost, where the overshadowing of Almighty God comes upon you and a holy thing is born on the inside of you. The new man, a new creation, the very life of Jesus Christ reproduced on the inside of us, a wellspring springing up continually, giving to us all the life of God. His very life, his very existence, bubbling up into a river that flows out of us in an unlimited expression of the power and the glory the person. That's a lot to want, and Father's given it all to anybody who really wants it. But after Abraham had gone through so many things, the Lord says, take now your only son, the son that you love, and bring him in a 3 days journey, take him a 3 days journey, and offer him as a sacrifice on the mountain that I will show you. If there's any time you don't want to get direction from God, this is how sovereign God's direction is. When God, it's like an old man of God told me. He said, when God speaks, I guarantee you'll know it because he don't stutter.
Yeah.
He don't speak in terms of possibilities. It's absolutes. It comes on you and seizes you. No, long ago, 1980, I saw a vision of this whole region. I saw a vision in the spirit where from Otay Mesa to San Onofre, from the coast to Warner Hot Springs, the sound of divine power, God's glory, being heard audibly. Back at that time, it was called Jack Murphy Stadium. Now it's called something else, Qualcomm or whatever. And we were standing there, didn't need any lights. The presence and the glory of God that was manifested. And it was a sound that could be heard throughout the whole region. It's going to happen.
Amen.
Amen.
It's going to happen. It's going to happen. And for this we labor, for this we press in, for this we pray, we fast, we give ourselves to obeying God, to do the things he's given to us to do and declared in his word that we're supposed to go and do and preach the gospel in all the world and continue to move out in faithfulness and obedience and then watch God put it all together.
Amen.
Watch him put it all together.
That's right. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. The fear of the Lord comes at a high price. It's very important to the Lord. So he gave us the outpouring of the Holy Ghost without measure. Described in Isaiah 11:2. Spirit of the Lord. Spirit of wisdom and understanding. Spirit of counsel and might. The spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. Something that Christ Jesus expressed to us and showed to us, the fear of the Lord. Fear of the Lord goes beyond the awe of God, but it's encapsulated in being in awe of him. Be in awe of him in Sinat, the psalmist said. The yara, which is the Hebrew word for fear. The yara clearly does mean to be in awe, to be stunned, to be paralyzed, to be captivated. Yara. It goes beyond the sight to see. Of Ra'ah, and it has a relationship of Ra'ah to see, Yara, to be stunned, captivated in fear, paralyzed, in awe. That's for you. You and I can have this. We can look unto the author and finisher of our faith. We can be in awe. We can see him. Captivated. You can see Paul on the road to Damascus. He couldn't close his eyes, so they burned out. That's the only way to go down.
Yeah.
And he went down. He fell to the ground. Hallelujah. But then something greater even happened. Something greater happened. Galatians 1:16 describes to us the thesis of the New Testament. It was unveiled to him, revealed to him, that God had purposed to reveal his Son, Christ Jesus, within him. Immediately he conferred not with flesh and blood, but went out into Arabia for 3 years and received an abundance of revelation, which was then ultimately penned as 2/3 of the New Testament, the epistles of Paul. This glory being revealed in you and me. This glory that Jesus talked about when he invited us in. He says, come dwell in me. Come on. He opens up and says, come abide in me. Everybody, come dwell in me. What an invitation. Leave the world. Come out from among them. Come dwell with me. Come live with me. Come. Let me train you up. Let me mature you. Let me establish you in the ways of life.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woohoo. I'll give you the best mentor and the best teacher, the Holy Ghost is going to be with you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That day when God told Abraham, you're going to take Isaac and you're going to sacrifice him, Isaac died that day. He wasn't doing the George C. Scott thing, agonizing. Oh, God, are you like the God of the Amalekites? Somebody's going to have to do the movie right. I'm telling you. He was dead that day. This is a matured man of God who's the friend of God. That day he died. 3 days later, he's going to get raised up. That day he died. He went on a 3-day journey. And what did he say to his servants? He said, I, the lad and myself, we're going to go over yonder. They're country people. The lad and myself, we're going to go over there and we're going to worship. We shall return again unto you.
Whew. Hallelujah.
Where is the lamb? Where's the lamb? Where's the lamb? Cried Isaac. Here's the wood and here's the fire. Where is the lamb? John 1:29. Behold the lamb. That takes away the sin of the world. First Peter, what is it? 1:19. Not redeemed with corruptible things such as silver and gold, but by the precious blood of the Lamb. As a lamb. By the precious blood of Jesus as a lamb without spot or blemish. Revelation 5. Unto the Lamb. Bokad Ashita. He was slain. Abraham says, the Lord will provide for himself a lamb. I see him. Jesus said, he saw me. He saw me. He saw me and rejoiced. He was right there seeing, I see the lamb. He was saying, I see the lamb. The Lord will provide for himself a lamb. When the Lord cried out from heaven and said, stretch not forth your hand against the lad. For now I know that you fear me. The fear of God is very important, Father. That's why he speaks so much about it. And would you like to have spirit knowledge so you can speak to the rock and say, water, come out. You can say to the sun and moon, don't move. You can say to the axe head, float. You can say to the oil and to the flower, do not diminish. Spirit knowledge. Spirit knowledge that comes from the fear of the Lord.
Yes.
Just take that little phrase. Take that one little phrase, fear of the Lord. Mm-hmm. If you have a search engine, just put it in quotes, and then that way it won't go and search all the words. It'll just give the phrase for you. You'll find 30 of the most radical testimonies just off of that phrase, but then there are other phrases that mean the same thing, like the fear of God. But in that, or other phrases, just like I was referring to in Genesis chapter 22 and verse 12. Now I know that you fear God. This is where you find the knowledge of God. Fear God. People want to talk about the word of knowledge. It's only found one time in the Bible. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 8. The words, plural word, of knowledge twice in the Bible. Proverbs 19, Proverbs 22. But the knowledge of God, over and over again, the knowledge that you and I are supposed to be walking in, a knowledge that sometimes is going to be met with a lot of challenges. We rejoice in Him with joy unspeakable and full of glory, but now, if need be, we're in heaviness. Huh? We're weighted down with a whole bunch of fiery trials, circumstances. But be of good cheer. Be of good cheer. Learn how to rejoice. Huh? Learn how to be exceedingly glad in all of your tribulation. Because there's a God's working a far greater and wonderful thing for you that you can go that goes beyond your imagination or thinking or ability to conceive. There is a weight in glory. There is a place in glory that we have that far supersedes any kind of weight of tribulation and tough circumstances. God's working something out so that our faith will be found unto praise and honor and glory at His appearing. I'm going to tell you right now, I don't want to go to hell. Hell is a very real place called the lake of fire. It's an eternal torture chamber, and people who are unwilling to step in to God's offer of the life, His life, are going to spend eternity there. A principality called humanism says no. A principality, a fallen angel, of course, fallen angel is the derivative. That word's never found in the Bible. God just says the devil and his angels. And from the devil and his angels, we derive fallen angel. One of the devil's angels, to be more exact, biblically, rules in the Western world and is called, and he produces within people a mind-blinding spirit, an idea and concept and thinking called humanism, which doesn't allow anybody to go to hell. Which can't imagine how that a loving God would allow anybody to go to hell. Yet people are making choices and decisions every day that put them in hell. Right now. It causes all kinds of problems and turmoil and upset in their life because they choose. I was shocked, Ann and I, when we were ministering on the East Coast recently, saw a guy my age that I knew in high school, and he was like this old man, and he comes up to me and he's like, "Why aren't you gray?" And I'm like looking at him going, "Who are you?" He says, "I'm Mike who? Mike McNabb." I'm like, I tried not to look shocked. Are you kidding me? I mean, sin in his wages. And the guy had all the life sucked out of him from all the drugs and alcohol. I mean, he created hell for his life. People every day deciding to live in hell. It's going to get a whole lot worse, people. God in His love spent a great sacrifice for you and me by offering and binding His Son to the tree, tying him to the horns of the altar. And there would be no do not stretch forth your hand and slay the young man. He would go all the way. He was saying, "Abraham, will you go all the way with me? Will you be my partner? Will you go all the way with me? Will you choose what I choose? Will you do what I do? Will you go where I go? Will you be with me in my decisions, in my love, in my mercy, in my grace, in my righteousness, in my holiness, in my purity? Will you choose what I have chosen, or will you go your own way?" Many people faced with temptation every day choose to go and commune with demon spirits because there is an immediate gratification of demonic pleasure that they receive, but always has a wage with it of death, always has a wage with it of heartache and sorrow. Huh?
Yes, it does.
Wherein Father, but yet Father has given to us all things that we need that pertain to life and godliness so that we can live out the glory and the virtue. He's given us all power so that we can be strong in the strength of the Lord and power of His might, taking to ourselves the whole armor of God and be able to properly and effectively deal with spiritual wickedness and be tested at every point by the enemy and you know, tried or attacked by at every point by the enemy and not one time be overtaken. I write unto you, young men, because the word of God abides in you and you defeat Satan at every point. Jesus said, if you overcome as I overcame, you'll sit down with me in my kingdom, my throne, even as I sat down with my Father in His throne. He's inviting us to come learn how. Amen. Men are born in sin and shaped every day of their life in iniquity. Every day they're shaped and taught to be just like hell, just like devils, just like demon spirits. But one day, when you call upon the name of the Lord Jesus, you were born in righteousness. And if you've not called upon the name of the Lord Jesus and you've not been changed, if the Holy Ghost has not come upon you and made you a new creation, changed you into a new man, this is the opportunity right now, today, right now. The Holy Ghost will come upon you and you become completely new. New heart and new spirit. You have now the heart of God. God take His heart and reproduce His heart in you, because He'll reproduce the very life of Jesus on the inside of you. You become the temple of the Holy Ghost. Christ Jesus come dwell in you. Father come dwell in you. Wow. Hallelujah. All power being given unto you. Hallelujah. In Christ Jesus, who has all authority in heaven and earth, and He's in us and we're in Him.
That's right. Amen. Yeah. Thank you,
Jesus. What will you do with Jesus? No. You want to continue on in the life of religion?
No.
Religion. Religion's religion. Somebody, I was talking to an atheist on the airplane the other day. He said he's an atheist. I said, you're not really an atheist. Oh, yeah, I am. But at any rate, he said, religion is terrible. I said, I know. He looks at me shocked. He said, religion is probably the major problem of the world. I said, yeah, I agree. So when I'm saying those kinds of things and I'm agreeing with him, and finally he says, well, what are you talking about? I said, I'm talking about a living relationship with Almighty God where you are born again and you no longer belong to the family of the human race.
Amen.
You belong to a new race that was born in Jesus Christ, the family of God, name written in heaven. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And he's like, tell me more. Ann's trying to get some sleep by me. 2.5 hours later, we took off on the airplane. I said, hello, what's your name? When the airplane's lifting off in San Diego, right? And it was setting down in Houston. He's like, we're already here. I said, time flies. Everybody stand with me. Father has invited us into the most amazing life. Hallelujah. But I'm going to tell you right now, you listen to me. It's not a life where you can continue to live a life as a mere, in a mere human existence. It's not a life where you continue to live on your own, for yourself, with your own ideas. It's a life where you taught of God, now every day shaped by the Holy Ghost in purity. Shaped by the Holy Ghost every day in the splendor of His holiness and the splendor of His righteousness, to be taught of God, to walk in God's ways and His glory. The most blessed life. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
What will you do with Jesus? To everybody standing in this place today, I know many of you, probably every one of you, been introduced to religion, but I don't believe you've been introduced to Jesus. You may know about all the concepts that are taught within the theology of men, but has there come a change in your life to where that now your very existence is by the life of God? You, as it were, a branch, are dwelling in the vine. You so hooked up with the life of Jesus. And now that there is a fruit produced, that whatever you ask Father, He'll do it for you.
Amen.
Take all the fear away. You can't stop somebody who doesn't have any fear. Filled with the boldness of God. I mean, it's like, how can you go to these places? How can you go over here? Huh? Somebody said I was that guy, archaeology guy. What is that guy? Indiana Jones is the kingdom of God. Not Indiana Jones. Not Indiana Jones. I'm just an average, ordinary, run-of-the-mill, everyday Christian full of the Holy Ghost who lost a sense of fear about telling about people about Jesus. Hallelujah. And God makes our, oh, Malice are going to kill us. Malice is going to kill my sweet, darling, beautiful wife. Oh, no, what am I going to do? Never even crossed my mind. Never even crossed my mind. And they became our friends. And that's what the Lord do. Make, you know, make your enemies at peace with you. Amen. Now, if you're religious, I wouldn't go by you. It's not friendly territory. Let's just live big for Jesus. What the Lord is going to do with your life, Summer Spitzberg.
Yes.
What God is going to do through you. Makatana Moya. Where Father's going to take you and Daniel.
Amen.
Yes. Great signs and wonders. Great miracles, great exploits. This is what Father's doing. And every step in the, every day and every step in the road as you walk out this life in Him is simply preparation. God said, if you purify yourself from these things, then you should be prepared unto every good work. Meat for the master's use. Take me, Lord, like bread and multiply me to feed the hungry. Hallelujah. If you're watching right now by the web or by YouTube, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm not talking about religion or the ideas that you've heard about before. I'm talking about the Prince of Peace, the very power of Almighty God that is invoked by the name of Jesus. The power of that name is so hooked up with His person that when you call upon Him in sincerity and truth, heaven will feel where you're standing right now. Heaven will feel where you're laying right now. Heaven will feel where you're sitting right now. The power of God will come upon you and everything will be made new. And there will be challenges that things try to come claim your soul. Satan will try to come claim you, but God will keep you. He'll make a way for you, a way of escape. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You just stand in Him. He'll fill you up. Hallelujah. With life, He's going to give you abundant life. He's going to give you life enough to keep you happy all day long if you'll just do what He's, if you'll just sing His song. Hallelujah. If you just praise Him.
Yes.
If you just worship Him. This nation will change.
Yes.
This nation. This nation. We hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it does not matter what denomination they are. They will come under the grip of Holy Ghost power and conviction. And sin by the Holy Ghost will become exceedingly sinful. I am absolutely certain. I have been made certain by God the Holy Ghost that this is not the time of the end of this nation. But He shall preserve this nation. And this nation will continue on as a voice of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ to the nations of the earth. There may be hard and violent times ahead of us. That's not going to impact what I'm telling you. I'm going to tell you right now, the end is not yet. We look unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. We're passionate about it. But the end is not yet, for there's still a great harvest.
Yes. Yes.
You could make an argument that all the nations of the earth have already heard at one time. But there's going to come a day when all the nations of the earth will not want to hear anymore. Because if you think about that verse of Scripture could be a circular argument for every generation. Where they heard, then they fell away, and now ready to hear again. One day there's going to be no more harvest. One day men's hearts will be so turned against God. But that day isn't now. If you're not living completely and totally for Jesus Christ of Nazareth, you're not living for him at all. Mark it. That's what he says. If he's not Lord of all, he's not Lord at all. Believe it. If you're not being led by the Spirit and walking in the Spirit and being taught of God and hungry for the things of heaven, you're not right with God. You're backslidden. You listen to me. The life of God, the Spirit of the Son, hooks you up with everything that's going on in heaven, and you're passionate about the things of the kingdom, and you act like and talk like and look like and desire the same things that Christ Jesus revealed to us in his word. God revealed it to us in the pages of the Bible. Today you need to get right. If you're not right with God, God, who is exceedingly gracious and full of mercy, abundant in mercy, says, I give to you a means by which you can be cleansed. I give to you a means by which you can be healed, changed, empowered, refreshed, renewed. There's not a reason or an excuse to not fully live for the living God. And Father, at his great expense and cost to himself, provided for us the blood of Jesus to wash us and purify us, to make us holy and righteous, to give us clean hands and a pure heart, to take and wipe away all the past, to remove it completely, entirely remove it, to where it's remembered no more. Today we have for you the means by which sin can be completely and totally erased and never remembered again. So that you can every day be taught of God from this day throughout the ages to come. And especially to that moment in time and that day that you breathe out your last breath and you cross over, because you're going to stand before a holy God who demands holiness. You're going to stand before a righteous and pure and holy God who demands righteousness, purity, and holiness. Who every dimension of the world is at odds against him. The world hates him. It's time for God's people to recognize you can't be a part of it, can't be integrated with it. It's time to come out from among them. I'm amazed at how many people in the world know what lasciviousness is, and how few people in the church understand what lasciviousness is and participate with it. And God says it's a work of the flesh, and that they that do those things, the wrath of God abides upon them. And it's about time God's people begin to understand what iniquity is, what evil is, what worldliness is, what lasciviousness is, what uncleanness is. It's time you start living. And to say a separated life, it really doesn't capture this glorious life. To start living a glorious life, which is a separated life, a heavenly life, which has no hell in it, a Holy Ghost life, which has no demons in it. A life full of joy unspeakable and full of glory. A life full of peace that passes understanding. A life, come on people. Como shikande, moda sande. A life where the children's bread is to be healed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When you say, Father, give me this day my daily bread, you're getting everything. Spiritually, physically, materially. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Let me just tell you something. Christ Jesus, the living God, loves you so much. You cannot even begin to imagine how much. But you can come to know the love of God, which passes knowledge, the love of Christ. Hallelujah. And as you do, you're going to get so excited and so thrilled and so yielded, you're going to get filled to the full. Men and women of God, go ahead and be filled. Go ahead and be overwhelmed. Go ahead and be touched by the mighty power of the living God, so that you might go everywhere just being who you are as a new creation, not of this world, not belonging to the human race, but to the race of the divine, not belonging to the family of humanity, but belonging to the family of God. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Haremanda. And you can just walk around and be who God has made you to be, praising Him, worshiping Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Flowing in the realms of heaven, and watch how the world will change. Watch how many, wow, watch how much harvest is right there about you. Hallelujah. When you begin to move in the power of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In just a minute, I'm going to pray for everybody and anybody who wants prayer in the house. If you don't know Christ Jesus personally, if you've not been introduced to Him, we'll introduce Him to you. When you get introduced to Him, the power of heaven will come upon you and change you into a new creation. You'll have new desires, new appetites, new attitudes. It will be you. Instead of walking around in your spirit, you walk around in His spirit. Instead of walking around being harassed by demon spirits, you're going to be encouraged by the Holy Spirit. It just gets good and better and better. And if you're sick in your body or diseased in your body, we're here to pray for you. God will do the same thing for your body. Hallelujah. He'll come work a miracle for you, just like He works a miracle on the inside to change you, give you a new heart, new spirit. My goodness, Lord does that, how much easier it is to heal the physical body. Amen?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Whew. Praise the Lord. Just go ahead and get filled up real quickly. If you're not already, doesn't that feel good? Doesn't that feel good? That feels so good to me. I love it. Just living this all day long. And you can. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now I want you to get ready and worship the Lord. Now this time I want you to just hold for, just listen to me. I want you to get ready to worship the Lord with the way that He's blessed you financially. I want you to come to a place where you don't have any more financial problems. God wants you to come to a place where you don't have any more financial problems. In other words, finances is not a problem anymore. Because you don't even think about it anymore. It's not a problem anymore. It's not because your bank account's full. It's because it's just not a problem anymore. Because you stepped over into a realm of faith where God provides for you abundantly, okay? Now what He does out of that, once you get rid of your problem, your financial problem, hallelujah, is He's going to begin to work a faith miracle. Because the problem, you know, worry is praying for a bad result. I'm telling you right now. Just don't do that no more. Just start with thanksgiving and praise and confidence in God. Hallelujah. Know what Papa's going to do for you. Know what He's going to do for you. And let Him have His way. And be passionate about pursuing greater things in God. Be passionate about all that He's made available. But always walking it out. Knowing how to be content with this relationship. At the same time pursuing the change that has to come. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command a blessing upon you this day. I command you in Jesus' name. I command you right now. In Jesus' name, Lucy, be blessed. Be blessed. I command you now in Jesus' name. You be blessed with all spiritual blessings in a heavenly realm, with great boldness and confidence.
Yes,
God the Holy Ghost will produce great boldness and confidence.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
For you all day long. I command you to be blessed. I command it in Jesus' name. And obey. Everything around me has got to obey. Amen. The stormy wind, the threatening wind has got to cease. The waves, the sea, the roar of it, filled. Silence.
Yes.
Silence.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I command every one of you right now in the name of Jesus Christ to allow the glory of heaven to begin to develop in your life to where you just can't stop praying in the Holy Ghost. It's very difficult. Where you can't stop flowing in the anointing. You just can't hardly shut down the joy to frown. Amen. De rapaya. Somebody said, he's just always happy, not serious about anything. No, hallelujah. Exceedingly serious. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Baranombaya. Haramonda. Just come worship the Lord. Come worship Him. Boramandaya. You know, right now is where the meeting really begins. I'm going to tell you right now, it's where the meeting begins. It really does. Because the atmosphere is charged with prophecy right now. The atmosphere is charged with signs and wonders and miracles right now. But usually the way things go, this is where we're supposed to end. No, stay right in here and we'll just take it up for another level. Just stay right in here. Just don't move. Don't move. And we'll pick it up after we get something to eat or whatever. Hallelujah. How's your knee? How's your knee? Praise God. Do a couple of knee bends. Praise God. Okay, do a couple of knee bends. Those are knee lifts. Do knee bends. Just do some knee bends. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Go down like this a couple of times. There you go. You're looking good. Looking good. You're looking good. No arthritis in your hands. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that beautiful? And then it's just also easy, you know, the Lord just does it. You just sit in His presence. Just sit in His presence. Don't run interference with God by trying to tell Him what He's supposed to believe. You hear me? Do not run interference with God by telling Him what it is He's supposed to believe. Just sit there wide open. Our hearts are open, wide, wide open. Hallelujah. Let God do it His way, and I'm telling you, it comes easy. The miracle come easy. The signs and wonders come easy. Gifts of the Spirit come easy. Amen. Amen. Find a bunch of people. Hug them right now. Tell them that you love them in Jesus' name. If there's anybody in the place you need prayer for anything, come, we'll pray for you. Find people that you don't know. Don't just go to the people that you live with. If you would, please. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Pokorishina Mateyapa. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For the things of this earth, shaped by the power of God for mighty acts and mighty deeds by the Spirit of the Lord. In Jesus' name. Jesus. Borostakai. Everything's new. God says everything's new. Just believe it. Everything. God says I make everything new. I make all things new. What's up? Nasal.
Yeah, it's been
very, too long. Thank you, Jesus. Be healed. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command your nasal sinuses to open up. Amen. Ha-serenaya. What's up? Father, I thank you for touching my baby's body. That old cough got to get off of you in Jesus' name. Papa told you come sit in his lap the other day. And I would have prayed for you, and then it would have just pressed in to shut that thing down. Okay? Next time, come over and sit in my lap, and let me pray for you for a while. Come here, baby. We love you. Father, thank you for increasing the anointing and increasing the expression of heaven through the life of your servant.
Thank you, Lord
Jesus. Malasai. Malasai toast. Jesus. Jesus. Now, in Jesus' name. What do you want? Huh? You can have it right now. What do you want? Huh? You can have it right now. What do you want?
Spirit knowledge.
Thank you, Lord. See? It's that simple. You ask. You call, He answers. Ask and receive. Good dancing. Good dancing. You were looking good. You're looking good. Keep doing that. You're looking good. Well done. Well done. Oh, you guys were supposed to hold the baby up. Did you hold the baby up? You were waving him? Let me do it tonight where everybody can be a part of it. He's an amazing looking little guy. He's amazing. He's an amazing looking little guy. Amazing. Thank you, Father. We're going to dedicate him tonight, Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Beautiful. Beautiful little guy. Thank you, Jesus. Porastikaya. Moridinande. Manosekeda. Monasekitalaya. Mea Shataribe. Jesus. Jesus. What's up? Debbie, what's up?
I'd like a fresh anointing.
You would? Lift your hands towards heaven.
Thank you.
Oh, Bakia. Oh, Bakia. Oh, Bakia. Fresh anointing. Fresh. Fresh anointing. Lift your hands towards heaven. Tell the Lord how happy you are. Tell Him how happy you are and how blessed you are with Him. You tell the Lord how happy you are and how blessed you are with Him. And you start doing that now. From here on in, just do that. No matter what starts coming at you, just the threats, the accusations, the persecutions. Turn your heart towards heaven. Begin to tell the Lord how happy. Oh, it's just a lavaya. Sunayesta. Sunayesta. Sunayesta morishinkai. Sunayestai. Ha. Hallelujah. Halemonjese. Mauritana ikseto yibrise. Father, I ask you now in Jesus' name to ignite all nine gifts of spirit. They're sitting there as it were like matches ready to be lit. Just light up right now. Light up right now. Zabrus dagi kalimota. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for the name. Hallelujah. Come here, what's your name?
I'm Erica.
Erica, what do you want Jesus to do for you? Okay. Everything changes, Erica. God the Holy Ghost comes, takes over our heart, our attitude, our spirit, our thinking, everything. And He gives us the faith and the trust. He fills us with such a boldness and confidence. And today, in the name of Jesus Christ, I'll break everything in the past off of you. In Jesus' name, be filled with His glory. Be filled with His goodness. Be filled up with heaven. In Jesus' name. Mandastikiyate. Marastate. Lisa. Erica. Erica of God. From this day forward, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Walk in the light. Walk in the glory. Walk in His presence. Take hold of this wonderful realm of heaven where you mount up with wings. Begin to fly. Ha, ha, ha. In the glory of His anointing. In the glory of His presence. And I command in Jesus' name, Erica, be filled with the Holy Ghost. Be filled so that out of your belly begins to flow rivers of the Holy Ghost. Masetaya. Mandeam romokoshike. Mayena munchikaya putorishitaila. Mandodorostai. Eristan. Erica, washed in the blood. Washed in the blood of Jesus Christ. Washed in the blood. Washed with a new nature. Washed with a new heart. Washed with a new attitude. Washed. Cleansed. Made whole. Everything that has caused you to be hurt and broken and offended and sorrowful, healed now. Healed now. healed. Every prison that's tried to lock you in, now in Jesus' name, it opens. You restrain. The restraints will be there no longer.
Morande, bredeste, procara, membres, tilanda, medethest, medethesitala data, madeste, fethila tala. Rabate, deep on a monk, you say. I command you to be blessed in Jesus' mighty name. Harabonde. Harabonde, say. Now, what do you want? You want everything in Sri Lanka to be sold in your favor.
Yes.
Everything in Sri Lanka be sold in her favor now. And don't worry about it anymore. Don't concern yourself about it because we done said, proclaimed it. God heard and He's answered. So be blessed. Everything in Sri Lanka should be sold in your favor. And we call that a prophet. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Mendeshte. Brusande. So just begin to rejoice. Begin to rejoice.
Thank you.
Papa wants to get you over into rejoicing. He wants to get you over into gladness. Just get over into gladness. Get over, practice some gladness. Practice some gladness. Stand there and practice some gladness. Practice some. I tell you right now, if I get people to practice gladness and praise, I can get them in all nine gifts of the Spirit in no time. Amen. Thank you, Jesus, for the anointing.
Thank you.
Holy Ghost anointing. Holy Ghost anointing. Mandestu I prena subani ashi. Molange I preteya. Me eshi pona nefriti. Jesus. 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 What do you want?